And you were in the IRA. Hold on, let me rephrase this.
Don't be starting saying I was in the IRA. I would never have been in the IRA, only I was pushed into it.
No, I, of course you were. What I'm saying is you were, the IRA allowed you into their ranks without even knowing one of their most revered heroes.
They don't ask you like that. No, they don't ask you. They don't. But as I say to you, maybe if I had wanted to go into the IRA, I would have went away and I'd have learned all this stuff, you know what I mean? Obviously, to go into the IRA, you have to do a lot of reading. But I never wanted into the IRA. I went in because I was getting, not pressured, but directed towards it.
Yes, but they allowed you into the IRA without knowing much about, or anything, by your own admission, anything about Republican politics.
I think in the IRA in Belfast, you only need to be able to do one thing. Fire rifle, Aragon, that's it. You know what I mean? There's no such thing as all this going on about Patrick Pearce and all this, James Connolly and all stuff like that. I mean, people aren't interested in that. I mean,
what stage did you realise that a man was going to be murdered and that you were going to be part of the team who murdered him?
What happened with Harrison was, as I say, I was running about and I was doing a lot of things and I was more or less doing things that was getting me into a terrible lot of suspicion, bringing me into a terrible lot of suspicion. What happened with Harrison was, I had been tipped off by a person in the IRA that they were targeting a member of the British Army. I told a member of the UDR, Ulster Defence Regiment, because obviously there isn't very many British soldiers in Ireland, right? Not unless they're
living there.
Yeah, I mean, you understand? So I went where an IRA man up to the Hollywood Road, where the British soldier was supposed to get off a bus and walk into the estate just off of Hollywood Road. So we went there and he didn't turn up. This wasn't to shoot him, this was just to check the area out. And we went, he didn't turn up. So after we checked the bus stop, the IRA man brought me into the street, which I know was in Evis Avenue area. And he looked along every house in the street. So I obviously didn't know what house it was. I just knew it was in Evis Avenue. And I told my handlers about this, and they brought me down, they checked the houses, and they read all the numbers down. And all I told them, all I knew was a British Army was getting, a member of the British Army was getting into one of the houses. So they took it UDR too, because obviously British Army people don't live there. And when they went and checked this, they read the numbers down, and they went to try and find out who he was, but they could never find out. So at this stage I had passed that on to my handlers, and a few weeks, a month later, I was called, somebody came to my house and asked me to go to a meeting up in Andersonstown, which I did. Obviously I didn't ring my handlers because I thought it was just a meeting. And I went and I was told that I was going on an operation and I was to drive with an IRA man in a car to the Hollywood Road. The car had been hijacked and waiting it all for me. At one stage I says this could be a tester because these guys don't usually do this. They usually give you notice. It's very unusual for them is to go and get you and just throw you in the hijack car. So we done as what we're told and we went to the Hollywood Road and I was brought into Nevis Avenue and parked at the bottom of the street in like a small car park. When I parked there, one of the guys who was with me got out of the car and walked around the corner and met another guy. And they walked up the street and they told me, if you hear any shots, drive up the street, stop the car, let us in, and we'll drive away.
So was it only at that point that you realised someone was about to be assassinated?
I knew somebody was getting assassinated when I went into the house and I was told the car was hijacked. But there was no way that I could have rang anybody because...
Why not?
I had an IRA man in the car with me the whole way. He didn't get out until I was parked in the car park, right at about 20 yards from the front door where the shooting was going to take place. And for me to run around a corner and phone my handlers, I would never be able to do it in 10.
You still? Yep. Okay. 45 on the front.
How did you feel about the fact that you couldn't have... How did you feel about the fact that you didn't have an opportunity to warn your handlers that a murder was about to take place and that you were going to be part of that murder team?
I was very nervous because I thought, because I hadn't told my handlers, as I always did, that there would be a chance if there was any army or police presence in the area, I could be shot dead for something that I didn't want to do, and also something that I hadn't got no control over. So obviously I felt a wee bit scared. But at the same time, having said that, it came into my head saying to myself, like, if this goes ahead with, maybe there's a chance, if there's any suspicion on me, it may clean up a wee bit. It's a bad thing to say, but at the end of the day, you know what I mean, I had saved a terrible lot of lives. And if I thought this here could have made me look as if I was on their side, so be it.
On the IRA side.
You know what I mean? Because if I could have stopped them from having said that, if I could have got the phone, I think I would have saved his life. Because I was in worse situations, and I went ahead and kept saving lives.
Can you remember what happened when the two gunmen left your car and ran up to the house? Do you remember hearing shots?
I can remember very clearly. What happened was they got out of the car, and I was sitting, and I remember a man walking up the street, and a girl too, and they were looking at me in the car, and I got a bit nervous, because obviously, like, you're standing in front of me, and when I hear shots, I'm supposed to drive. So what am I supposed to do? Drive over top of these people? So, as I say, tell you, they moved anyway, and the guys who went into the house were in the house for a good, 40 seconds is a type of long time when you're sitting in a getaway car, knowing somebody's going to get you dead. Very nerve-wracking. 2 seconds, the police could drive around a corner and open up. So I sat there. And to tell you the truth, I was praying that because I had tipped my handlers off about this beforehand, that they had been watching this house from across the street and maybe caught everybody. Because I knew then I would rather be caught than be shot dead. And I heard the shots anyway. I heard 5 shots. I drove up the street, and the two of them just walked out of the house, calm. I couldn't believe it. Walked out, opened the door into the car. And at this stage, I was driving the car, and I remember the wheels were skidding. And the more I put my foot down, the more the wheels were skidding. And somebody followed me out of the street in the car. But anyway, I got away, and I dropped the two guys off. And they made their own way back. And I remember driving in this estate about maybe 2 miles up a road. And I parked the car up against the wall, and I got out and walked away, and I threw my gloves away, just down in the street. I was just depressed, because I knew that what had happened, right? And I was just praying that he wasn't dead. But I says to myself, come in the real world, you know what I mean? They shot him 5 times, I heard it, bang, 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 5 times. And I more or less says to myself, Jesus Christ, you know what I mean? I didn't know what to think. I says, I'm going to go to jail for this. Because obviously, like, I'm involved in an IRA operation, even though I was working for the police. I can still be prosecuted for it.
And what did your handlers told you would happen to you if you were caught?
They told me that I'd go to jail. No 2 ways about it. They told me I'd be prosecuted.
So did you tell your handlers afterwards or not?
I didn't. I was too nervous. I couldn't tell them because I thought there was a chance that I could go to jail. I didn't imagine telling them.
Did you ever tell them?
I did tell them. I told them a few months later when my cover was blown. And I had to come away because I was kidnapped by the IRA. And when I came away, they told me that they want everything that I hadn't told them about, more or less, wiped the slate clean. And I told one of my handlers, and he says, Jesus, don't tell, I don't want to hear. But I think he passed that on because people who was involved with the shooting were arrested. And I don't exactly know what happened. But it's all only come out in the opening, now, more or less.
When you saw the news the night that soldier, that young soldier, was shot, how did you feel?
I felt bad because it just so happened when I get back to the house, I had just been in and the news was coming on and I seen it. It just says right away, there was no cutting corners, or there was no, a man is seriously injured. It was a man's dead, that was it, just clean cut, the man's dead. Two armed IRA men burst into the house, shot him several times in the head. And I says, Christ, this is getting worse. I didn't think it was going to be as bad as this. It's getting worse than I thought it was going to be. I was praying when they hit that house, my handlers would have had him moved, but they hadn't. But when I heard the shots, I said, God, this couldn't be real. This isn't happening. When they had shot him, and I had seen the news, the people who did shoot him, came to my house afterwards, and I said, do you want to go for a drink? And he said, no, I don't want to go for a drink. I was depressed, and I mean, they're going to go up and drink after shooting someone here, and he says, no. So I sat in the house, and what happened was, these two guys were running about like heroes for the next few days. Everybody thought it was great because they shot a soldier. So as I say to you, I was in a position where I couldn't do nothing about it.
But when you finally told your handlers, what was their reaction?
Their reaction was that they did more or less want me to mention. They were expecting me to mention things, wee stupid things. And when I mentioned something that serious, they were shocked.
When you say wee stupid things, what sort of things?
I mean, like wee stupid things, like I moved weapons about 2 nights ago and didn't tell you about it. Or I was out firing a rifle 2 nights ago and I didn't tell you about that. They weren't exactly expecting me to say that I was involved in driving a getaway car for a murder.
So what did they actually say to you when you told them you'd been involved in murder?
One of them told me, I didn't he, forget about it. And he must have passed it on because people who was involved in it were arrested and it was a big coincidence. The police knew who they were.
All right, cut it there. I mean, it's fine, isn't it?
Right. The reason why I done it for was because my handlers had a very, very hard job. They were fighting people who hid against or hid behind walls. They wouldn't come out in the open, and they were doing things like it. And I always knew deep down in my heart that the police were the law. They were the people who had the authority to do what they were doing, and the IRA were just, in my eyes, a bunch of people who wanted to try and make a name for themselves. And at the end of the day, they haven't succeeded.